KSE-FM HD1. Broomfield, Denver, Boulder. The Nuggets, Avalanche, Rapids, play here. This is Altitude Sports Radio.
Knock with the right hand!
Get out of town!
92.5.
No!
Michelob Ultra, superior light beer. 2.6 carbs, 95 calories. From the Michelob Ultra Studio.
So, I need a ruling on this. Much like should spring have hit the drop with James Lofton. Here's the ruling. Is there such a thing as a big Jaguars game in the year of our Lord 2021?
Here's Nate Kreckman and Andy Lindahl.
Open mouth, say words. It's Kreckman and Lindahl, Altitude Sports Radio 92.5. It is hour number three of the show. Broncos Ravens coming up here this week. Thanks again to Jeremy Kahn of 105.7 The Fan there in Baltimore. Good to have him here on the program. We're going to talk to Nick Groke coming up at 4:45 this hour. What the heck are those Rockies doing? Talking to the Grokester today here at 4:45. We asked Jeremy Kahn about it, specifically Andy asked Jeremy Kahn about it. Back issues, I think hip issues as well. Has not practiced yet this week, has not played yet this season. Erstwhile Bronco Derek Wolf, we should not anticipate seeing him on the field Sunday against the Broncos. They still got Calais Campbell. They still got Brandon Williams. They still got a solid and getting healthier front seven. They have been brutal against the pass so far this year, but with those guys coming back, you would think, perhaps, and especially against this banged-up Broncos offensive line, that Baltimore will be slightly more dangerous up front. Still, no Derek Wolf, which is a little bit disappointing. Andy, when you think back on this, I always like to kind of rely on your Broncos historian abilities here. How do you characterize Derek Wolf and sum up kind of what he was in the pantheon of this organization?
He was one of their better draft picks, quite honestly. They traded out of the first round. They thought they were going to draft Doug Martin that year. They chose not to. I'd had a bunch of intel that said they loved you. This is people lying to you around the draft. Intel telling you they love Doug Martin, then they trade their exact pick to Tampa Bay so they can pick Doug Martin. They move back. They grab Derek Wolf, who allegedly Baltimore was interested in back during the draft. And, you know, I would say he's up there with Rulon Jones, who was another guy that people loved as a defensive lineman back in the day for the Broncos back in the 80s. I mean, he's one of the best defensive linemen they've had. I'm trying to, you know, Alfred Williams. Like, I feel like Alfred was almost like a lineman, but he was a linebacker because he was so big.
Yeah.
So he's in that category for sure. Just, look, the Super Bowl teams aren't the same without him. Vaughn said it at the podium today. He said that he got a number of his sacks because Derek was taking up, occupying offensive linemen so he could get home. And he said, frankly, he just got there prior to Derek Wolf getting some of those sacks.
Yeah, Von Miller, let's hit that cut right there. Von Miller talked about his former teammate, Derek Wolf.
Oh, yeah, you know, Derek Wolf, you know, we're all buddies, and you know, I haven't seen him in a minute, so it'd be good to you know, have him back here in Maha Stadium and have him back here in Broncos country. I'm sure they'll give him, you know, a warm welcome. He did a lot of great stuff for us. You know, 80 of my sacks, you know, come from, you know, rushing with Derek Wolf and him helping me out and, you know, doing all the things to help me become the player that I am today. So I'm very grateful of me and Derek's career together and me and Derek's time together. And I got a lot of sacks because of Derek. I took a lot of sacks away from Derek. You know, he was right there, you know, so half of those sacks could have been his as well. So I'm very appreciative of me and Derek's time together for sure.
Yeah, good player. And Andy, really, when I think back on the career of Derek Wolf, I mean, it damn near was almost like a what couldn't have been. He had a freakish injury that he had to deal with early on in his career. What was that? I think it was the 2013 season when he took that hit in the preseason. It was a stinger. It was giving him seizures. They had a scary incident on the team bus with Derek Wolf. He lost a ton of weight, and he was I mean, there's no nice way to say it. He was getting his ass kicked out on the field that season. He could not get pushed over basically on a play. He had lost a ton of weight. It was bad. And you kind of assumed, like, at that point, it was like, oh, okay, like, Bustola, bad injury. This guy's finished. And to me, like, that's what I kind of remember about Derek Wolfe is, like, that guy was damn near toast. And he came back and turned into a really, really good player.
Isn't it funny you bring up 2013? Because Vaughn also had his year of nearly falling off the NFL face of the planet with the suspensions and the knee injury and everything else in 2013. And then they come back. I remember Vaughn talking about it a couple years ago. I want to say it was 2017, 2018, where he talked about how he and Derek could rush the passer and kind of like offensive linemen, not a lot of communication needed. They'd get a look. They'd give each other a look. They'd know, I'm going to do this. You're going to do that. That's what's going to free me up. They just had such a great chemistry together. And as much credit as we all deservedly give DeMarcus Ware for getting Vaughn probably right off the field and focused on football the way that he needed to, I don't know without Derek and Wolf and Vaughn Miller together if either player's, frankly, as effective as they ended up being in their career. They just were that great tandem together for rushing the passer, and Wolf was so good against the run. Wolf was the mean, crazy guy you kind of needed. He was kind of like the Romo to me of the, you know, that 2013 and 2015, not really 2013, you laid it out there, but 2014, 2015 run of the defense being pretty good. But I guess if we're being fair about it, who was really the best defensive lineman off that Super Bowl line? Was it he or was it Malik Jackson? Well, now, when you had them both going.
Right. Malik got paid a lot more than Wolf did. Wolf took the team-friendly deal, but that was also, I mean, this is, you got to chalk this up as you know, wise football executive work here by John Elway, that he got Derek Wolf, who had dealt with the neck injury, and Chris Harris, who had had a torn ACL, and he got those two guys to take team-friendly deals before the season was out versus Malik Jackson and Danny Trevathan, who then went to the open market and made huge bucks, especially Malik. Like, he got a disgusting contract with Jacksonville.
Yeah, Jacksonville had some bucks to throw around, and they definitely threw Malik's way. But
yeah,
look, Malik was an interior rushing force.
He's good.
Now, how much of that was helped out by Derek Wolfe and Vaughn Miller doing stuff on the outside? I mean, they all really fit well together. And we'll see Malik here in a couple weeks or month when they play the Browns. So, I don't know. Derek is one of the – I want to put him top five, minimum top ten defensive linemen, I think, in franchise history.
So – going just by sacks, which it's not a perfect metric here because he wasn't necessarily just a pass rushing defensive end. He did that role sometimes. Wolf, 14th all time Broncos history with his 33 sacks, tying him with Ma'a Tanivasa on that list right there. Derek Wolf, to me, Andy, ring of very good, just shy of Ring of Fame Bronco.
Yeah, he's not. Vaughn Miller kind of reps the whole thing from Ring of Fame Bronco.
Yeah.
Chris Harris, because he was your guy, in my opinion, maybe.
I think he's a
reps
Ring of Fame
the whole
Bronco.
Secondary for Ring of Fame Bronco.
Yeah.
But the guys are representative of the defense they played with, right?
Yes. 2015, Vaughn is in. DeMarcus Ware, even though only three seasons as a Bronco, I think the rule should be changed. I think he should be in the Broncos Ring of Fame. Chris Harris, Aqib Talib. I would put those four guys off of that defense into the Ring of Fame.
See, it's funny when you talk defensive linemen, and please, for some of the folks that maybe remember better, help me out here. 309-33, Chomp Automotive text line. Like, I'm trying to remember. I remember Rulon Jones. I remember Lyle Zato, who I believe was a defensive lineman. I need some people helping me when we get back that far. But the Broncos are known more for linebackers, especially when you look at the sack numbers, Nate, because they've been a 3-4 team more often than a 4-3 team. Joe Collier was 3-4. Wade Phillips was 3-4. On and on and on. So they've had, to me, more – they've had better linebackers. Like, Simon Fletcher, that was a linebacker. Now, a lot of times he'd get down and plays an end, and let's be honest, a lot of Vaughn sacks have come with him getting down and playing the end in the nickel, but he's a linebacker. So that's why I'm comfortable saying I think Derek Wolf's probably up there, but I need some help with, from some folks that maybe could jog my memory of some. Trevor Price was a great defensive lineman.
I was
going to
say, Barney Chavis, little love there.
Yes, no, there's absolutely. Mm-hmm. I cannot forget him. I'm glad you remembered him.
Mm-hmm.
Rich Tombstone Jackson, I think was. Would I love the old names, by
such
the old
a badass
by
name.
The way. So I believe he was a defensive lineman, but I need someone to help me with that just going off the top of my head. Like Def Halen said, he's better on Twitch. He's better than Tanivasa. There's no doubt about it. Tanivasa found himself in the right situation for a couple of years.
Yes.
And kind of did his thing. But like they drafted Dan Williams. He ultimately went on to be a better Chief than he ever was a Bronco. Gosh, Nate, I mean, I just can't think of a ton of defensive linemen that have been true forces.
Yeah, it's to your point. It's not what the Broncos are most known for, but they've had some good ones through the years. Again, Derek Wolfe, if there's a ring of very good, I would put him in it. Altitude Sports Radio.
Altitude Sports Radio 92.5. Kreckman and Lindahl.
Going to talk to our buddy Nick Grove coming up here at 4:45 on the program. Going to talk about these Rocks. The home portion of the schedule is completed. Three more against the Diamondbacks, and then this season comes to a merciful close. The year that began with the trading of Nolan Arenado to the Cardinals back on February 1st. Nolan is now on his way to the wild card game to play the Dodgers for the Cardinals, who finally did lose last night, although they really didn't care because they had clinched that wild card game. Jeff Breidich resigned back on the 26th of April. It was basically crickets at the trade deadline, and now they go into a critical offseason for the direction of the ball club and to eventually decide on who is going to be the general manager, who we all know it's going to be Bill Schmidt. So that's what's afoot.
I'm learning something here that may help our little topic that you stumbled upon here.
Okay.
Now, I got to go find this video.
Mm-hmm.
Hastings has been texting me. You know, Hastings played in the 80s.
Okay.
We may have to call him. I got to see if I can find this video. We were going over all the songs. There it is.
80s sports rap songs?
Oh my gosh, I asked Hastings, was he part of a song? Spring, check your email. I'm sending this to Spring. I don't have any idea how bad this is, but Hastings said, yeah, he was part of Atlanta's Air Force, which I've never heard of.
Nice.
But apparently, so I'm going to send this to Spring, and I believe we got to try to get Hastings to comment on his involvement in this thing.
So what year of Atlanta Hawks would this have been?
Well, I'm watching it now. Man, it's so 80s, it's grainy. Fratello's the coach.
Okay.
I think is
the czar of the telestrator.
This is so bad. This is so bad, Nate. I'll just give it to you on Twitch a little bit.
Okay.
It is just, look at that. I don't even know who that dude is. Oh, man. Spud Webb, I think, is there.
Spud was on this team? Okay, right now I'm looking at the 84-85 Atlanta Hawks right here. Obviously, they had Neek, Eddie Johnson, Doc Rivers. Wow, Cliff Levingston was on that team. He would win titles with the Bulls. Tree Rollins was on that team. And indeed, they had a 24-year-old lanky big man out of Arkansas by the name of Scott Hastings, who averaged 3.8 points and 2.5 rebounds per game. So a 4.5 season that year for Scott Hastings. Like, did he have a verse, or was he playing like woodblock?
Spring, just call him. Let's just see if he picks up. I think he's around. I don't know.
One of the things that I always remember about the Super Bowl shuffle is like Maury Buford playing like the cowbell off to the side.
Maury Buford?
He was the punter on the 85 Bears. But they always had to work in like get the other guys participating in this whole thing.
Yeah, kind of like the We Are the World video.
Like,
We Are the World what started all this stuff? Did all the teams decided they needed their own We Are the World feel when they created this thing?
Yeah, I think it was very much along those lines. Have you ever watched the video of Bob Dylan during We Are the World? It's one of the funniest things you will ever see in your life. Like, one of the cameras just focuses in on Bob Dylan. He doesn't know any of the words. He doesn't want to be there. He wants no part of this whole thing. He just kind of moves his lips, not even close to what the tune is, and has the grumpiest look on his face you could imagine.
Well, I mean, you know.
Yeah.
What are you going to do? I don't think half the guys wanted to be there, frankly, that were there.
Bobby Bonilla did not win a Mets MVP, although we got a couple of more votes on this. You guys are doing well here. Yes, Willie Mays did win. He did close out his career with the Mets. He obviously won several MVPs with the Giants. And Joe Torre did win an MVP in 71 with St. Louis. He also closed out his career with the Mets. So I think we're still three names away on our list of the 10 MVPs that played for the Mets, even though the Mets have never had an MVP of their own.
And what was their song?
Get Metsmerized.
Get Mets.
Metsmerized, see?
Okay, now I got to know, is there some Denver Nuggets song I didn't know about?
I hope
the Rockies, by the time the Rockies came to town, it won the 80s, so I don't think this was a thing anymore.
Did the Broncos ever do one?
Not that I remember.
Okay.
Not that I remember.
All right.
Not like a rap or anything. Now, there were, again, when the Broncos first went to the Super Bowl in 86 and played the Giants, there were people, you know, there was that Johnny Angel song that people turned into Johnny Elway and Go Johnny Go is what I'm trying to say.
Okay.
That was a song. There was something about the Rocky Mountain Thunder, but I don't remember a rap video or any of that going
ever made to celebrate. And they had great teams in the 80s. You would have thought they would have done it, that they would have fallen into that trap. Apparently they did not. See, my favorite, and even though I grew up on the Super Bowl shuffle in the 85 Bears, my favorite was Let's Ram It, which the LA Rams did in the mid-80s as well. That chorus is very catchy. I'm a huge fan of Let's Ram It. That was probably my favorite. It's also kind of inappropriate.
Right. Well, we all figured. I mean, people know you well. People that know the show know what's going to float your boat. Ring the bell for you. As
speaking
it
of slightly inappropriate, you ready for Screwball of the Day? You should.
Sure. Yesterday's going to be tough to top, dude.
Yeah.
I got to give you credit, okay? Oftentimes, like, again, you were on Joe Exotic before we knew there was going to be a Netflix series
The
guy. And now you brought up the guy that joined the search party to help find him himself. I'd not seen anything about it on Twitter and woke up today as if you alerted the world, put a spotlight to the Twitter world about this guy. I've seen not only three stories, but much mocking of the man who found himself. By the way, shout out to the text line. A lot of people thought the Screwball of the Day should have been paid money for finding himself. Could he collect the reward?
Collect the reward.
Yeah.
He found himself. Today's Screwball of the Day, I got a great team name here for you, Andy. You ready for this? All right. Screwball of the Day, presented by Screwball Peanut Butter Whiskey. It's the original peanut butter whiskey. It's delicious. Pick it up anywhere and enjoy it. It's great in the fall. Okay, take it out to the tailgate and enjoy Screwball Peanut Butter Whiskey. Okay, so collegiate summer baseball, the Cal Ripken League. This is an East Coast Maryland thing, not quite up to Cape Cod level or Alaska level. I don't even know if it's as good as the Rocky Mountain Collegiate Baseball League that we have here on the Front Range. But the Cal Ripken League in Maryland, new ball club playing in the Cal Ripken League, Olney, Maryland. All right. And on the ball club's Instagram, they're trying to get fans to vote on the new team name. So here are many of the candidates right here. The Mechanics, the Bat Flippers, the Ogres, the Gold Rush, the Mumbo Jumbos, and the Octopi. These were all candidates, but they all came up short to the eventual winner for the new Olney College baseball team in Maryland. Andy, we live in a world where there is a ball club known as the Olney Crop Dusters.
Yes. Yes.
The crop dusters on fan vote coming summer 2022. Crop Dusters Baseball will be in your life, I would assume. Their merchandise will be popular on the internet. Find it as quickly as you can. The only Crop Dusters.
All right. So Hastings can take the call,
okay,
but he's about to go get a haircut. So what do we want to do here?
What's his priority here?
Hey, we ain't getting him out of the chair. I can tell you what his priority is. What's our priority?
Our priority is to hit a break and stay on clock so we don't get in trouble. It's Crackman and Lindahl, Altitude Sports Radio.
Great to talk to you. I love the show.
Callers are welcome on the Quality First Service Group listener line.
Appreciate you.
303-504-0925. Quality First Plumbing, Heating, and Electric. Cue the number one, SG.com.
We always like to keep an eye on these kind of rankings. This isn't Power Ranking Tuesday. This is Quarterback Index Thursday, apparently. But Greg Rosenthal, NFL.com, Andy, Teddy Bridgewater right now ranking at 15th best quarterback in the NFL so far this season, trailing Kirk Cousins at 10, Russ at 11, Josh Allen at 12.
Josh Allen.
Ryan Tannehill at 13. Baker Mayfield at 14. There is Teddy Bridgewater coming in at 15th, currently second in the NFL, completing 76.8% of his passes. 15th, Andy, that's top 15. That's good company.
Maybe all they need.
I think
it's all they need to get into the playoffs. Mm-hmm. So just keep that going, and I think you'll be fine. I'm a little surprised he's behind Kirk Cousins, but hey, whatever.
Cousins is...
keep doing your thing.
Like, he's been good. So far this year, he's a...
believe it when we get to the playoffs.
I'm just... through three games, he's been good. He's going to... he'll Kirk Cousins back out. Don't you worry about that. Right now, here's your top 10 on this list. Brady at 1, Dak at 2, Derek Carr at 3, Stafford at 4, and Aaron Rodgers at 5. Patrick Mahomes outside the top 5. How do you like that, Pat? Justin Herbert at 7, Lamar at 8, Kyler Murray at 9, and Kirk Cousins at 10. Yeah, Kirk Cousins, so far this year, 8 touchdowns, no picks for those Minnesota Vikings. So yeah, he's playing to the Kirk Cousins peak through 3 games.
Sure, good for him. The guy's annoyed me ever since he's doing that. You like that? You like that? Shut up.
Yeah, definitely. I wouldn't put him on the likable list. That's for damn sure. Worst quarterback in the NFL. Let's see who's coming in at 32 on this list. There he is, Davis Mills. Sorry, Davis Mills. You have to be number 32 on this list.
Well, that'd be why Brett Rippon was maybe a guy they considered bringing into Houston, Texas there. So.
Probably a good idea. Yeah, we're getting you ready for some TNF tonight. Thursday night football, the Bungles 7.5-point favorites against those Jacksonville Jaguars. Right now, it is time for our Pick 4 Pick'em contest here on the Crackman and Lindahl Show on Altitude Sports Radio 92.5. It's presented to you by Tipico Sportsbook. Let's make this interesting. And Screwball Peanut Butter Whiskey, the original peanut butter whiskey available near you. You want to listen for your cue to call every single day. And then when you call in, you could qualify and you could get picked, just as our picker was this week. If you go a perfect 4-0 against the spread, college or pro, you will win yourself $925 just for participating. You will win $100 in free bets to Tipico Sportsbook. Andy, our guest picker this week, our Pick 4 player on the Crackman and Lindahl Show, is Miles. All right, we only have 1 mile, not 500 miles. Miles, welcome to the show. How are you?
I'm good. Thank you for the intro.
Yes, awesome. It's Miles. I believe you're the first guest picker this season that got his own theme music. Were you a fan of that tune? What was that, The Proclaimers, I believe?
You know, believe it or not, it's not the first time I've ever heard it used with my name. So.
I can't believe that, Miles. Okay.
All right. Has someone sang it to you, Miles? Have you had to endure a karaoke version of that thing?
Oh, you betcha.
Have you ever sung that song at karaoke?
Yeah. No, I haven't, unfortunately.
Do you have blonde hair and glasses?
Yes, I do, actually.
Wow! Look at that!
Oh, Miles. It's all coming together. Hey, Miles, let's just get in the tree of trust because, you know, we're about to win you a bunch of money anyway. So did a young lady ever sing it to you and you had to act like you liked the version of it?
You know, if a young lady did sing it to me, I probably would act like I did, but it never happened.
Okay. Well, ladies, if you're lucky
that'd
enough to meet Miles, way. Now we know what will work for him, okay?
Once he's rich from hitting this pick'em.
That's right.
Now you know your way in.
You'll be beating him off with 500 sticks,
that's
okay?
Right.
All right, Miles, do you understand the rules?
Yes, sir, I do.
Okay, you got to make four picks against the spread, college or pro. If you go perfect 4-0, you win yourself $925, pushes or losses. Miles, are you picking college or pro? Are you mixing and matching? What do you got for us?
I'm actually just going to do all pro.
Okay, you got four NFL games that you like this week. All right, Miles, here we go. We got the lines here on Tipico Sportsbook, which everybody should sign up. One of the proud presenters, along with Screwball Peanut Butter Whiskey, of our Pick 4 Pick'em contest. Miles, what is game number one?
So game one, I got Tom Brady and the Bucks over the Patriots.
Okay, you're going to take Tampa. Let's see the latest line here. On Tipico has Tampa, what is it up to? 6.5. Actually, that's a pretty good number to get it at right there at 6.5. All right, Tampa at New England, Bucks laying 6.5. Andy, I don't even have to ask you. I know you love that pick. All right, let's go on to your next pick right there.
The next pick, I'm going to go with the Chiefs at, I think it's 6.5 over the Eagles.
Okay, Kansas City laying 6.5 on the road at Philly. Andy?
Oh, how can you not take this game? I mean, I don't know if you're going to win a lot of money on the game, but Miles certainly is going to win
Miles,
a lot of money on the
game. Yes.
But if somebody else is going to Tipico and betting their own money, you're going to have to bet quite a lot to get anything out of it. But, yeah, there's no way the Chiefs are losing 2 weeks in a row, especially when the second team is Philly. Philly's a mess.
All right, Miles, third pick.
For my third pick, I'm going to take the Rams, and I think it's 4.5.
Got L.A. laying the 4.5 at home against those undefeated Cardinals. Pair of undefeated NFC West opponents. Divisional matchup, Andy. What do you think?
I like it. Probably his risky one yet, but I like it. I like the Rams more than I like the Cardinals. Arizona's still – now, Kyler Murray's been the best – he's been one of the best quarterbacks in the league thus far, right? I think I even saw the top fantasy quarterback for what that's worth.
He is the betting favorite for MVP right now.
Well, there you go. Mm-hmm. But I think the Rams made a loud statement the other night against the Bucks.
And finally, Miles.
I'm probably going to hate myself for doing it, but I'm going to take the Broncos over Baltimore.
Denver laying right now on Tipico. You're getting a half a point right there, or, you know, you're laying half of a point. Broncos minus the 0.5. Right there at minus 108. So essentially, you're making a money line bet right there. Andy?
You know, I worry about the Broncos losing the two guards this week. Now, Vic Fangio hasn't ruled them out, but it just feels to me like we're headed that direction. And frankly, both in Glasgow in particular were really struggling even before they got hurt. And you just wonder about this. But man, our guy Jeremy Kahn felt pretty good about the fact that the Ravens are not very good. So, Miles, a tip of the cap to you. I think it's a good way to go. I just I don't want you ending up like our friend a couple weeks ago that had the 16-leg parlay with it all relying on the one team that was least likely to win their games. So, of everybody you've picked so far, I think Denver's the least likely. But they're at home. So good luck, my friend. We want to be celebrating with you next week.
All right, 500 miles trying to be 925 miles. Bucks minus 6.5 at New England. Kansas City laying 6.5 on the road at Philly. You got L.A. minus 4.5 against Arizona and the Broncos. Minus that half a point, essentially the money line bet on Denver at home against Baltimore. Those are your picks, Miles. You good?
Yes, sir.
All right,
thank
Miles,
so much.
Best of luck. We're rooting for you. Andy, this is the third out of three guest pickers that we have had on the show that have taken favorites across the board.
It's all right. It's got to work sooner or later. Same strategy's got to work somehow.
If it doesn't work, try again. Best of luck to Miles right there. It's our Pick 4 Pick'em contest. It's presented by Tipico Sportsbook, and we do it right here on Altitude Sports Radio 92.5.